When I look back at my work, I've realized that I've always been drawn to the natural world as my inspiration. At the same time, I've been drawn to technology, and in the early days to photography, because that was, you know, a vehicle that I could introduce into printmaking and transform again my hand drawing into sort of a combination of almost collaging with technology and hand. And as the culture moved more and more digital, so did I. Hi, I'm Vicki Scuri. I'm a public artist and designer from Seattle, Washington. And I've been practicing public art and infrastructure and basically creating public spaces for communities across the United States for about 35 years. I knew we wanted to use something that would connect people with place. The SLU offered a lot of opportunity to see forms in nature and light and pattern and hear the birds and, you know, all the animals that are out there. But technology allowed us to distill it into something that addressed the sort of high-tech neighborhood that surrounds the SLU, which is its opposite. I heard from the stakeholders and from the community that they really hated how the station interrupted the Mercer SLU, because it's basically like putting in a huge concrete box into a very natural environment. They wanted to dissolve it into the space if they could. And they also wanted color. They were concerned that the depth of the guideway and the depth of the girder was about 8 or more feet, 10 feet of concrete in the air, 20 feet up, that it was just gonna be brutal, like brutalist architecture from the 60s. So my challenge was to introduce human scale, to bring color, to mitigate this sort of presence in the SLU environment the best I could. Well, I looked at a lot of spots. I mean, I probably took hundreds or thousands of photographs out there. I was trying to figure out, you know, how I would use the photographs. You know, I hadn't really done the printmaking thing for quite a while. I had gone back to school and learned some digital design and fabrication, which sort of informed me that I could use photographs and take them into like a program called Grasshopper and make digital screens and layers, and I could, you know, transform what the literal looked like into something abstract that kind of fit better with my interpretation of technology and culture and nature. And what I'll say about technology is, if you don't have a strong point of view, technology will take over.
The challenge was going to be how to get rich, saturated color that was consistent panel to panel in exacting precision for a job that was going to take months to produce. So formulation of the colors, how we literally create the color as well as how we apply it, those are actually two different things. We may have a given color that is used on a job in many different application methods, and that actually requires unique formulas for the same color each time because of the medium that's used to carry that color and put it on the panel. She had very rich and vibrant colors, some of which were on the edge of what can be achieved in enamel.
We created prototype panels for review, and one of the things that we learned is that the purples and blues were hard to capture.
We wanted consistency of color more than we needed to have extremely fine detail, like this yellow line versus this magenta line that's next to it. And so by working with her to find out where that trade-off could be between the detail and the color, we were able to make very minor modifications in the art that gave us the ability to use a tool for printing the purple that was rich and saturated. And so it was all uniform, consistent, and beautiful for the project as a whole. Now we have to test those colors on panels that are the same size and shape as what the final work is. It's much easier to have process control and color control on very small pieces than it is on panels that are 4 foot by 6 foot 8. That large mass of metal that the finished pieces were going to be requires a longer time in the kiln. The part has to be in the kiln longer to get to the sufficient temperature so that the enamel fuses right. And in that additional time, color shifting can occur.
They understand how temperature affects the color and how the layering affects it, and they were able to nail it. A neighbor wrote to us and told us how much he liked the colors, how it reminded him of his childhood and the bright colors of, you know, things that he played with and the colors he liked. My intention is that it just brings joy and color and life into people's lives that otherwise wouldn't be there if it were just a standard, you know, transit gray concrete station. So my hope is that it will continue to welcome people for generations.